Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. We're going to get back in our Father's Word. 1 Timothy chapter 3 today. Remember, this is a doctrinal letter, meaning how you should handle the doctrine of Christ, how you should perform in your church, how you should, that is to say, how to run a church, so to speak, how you should act in a church. But also, let it apply to your family. You can't go wrong. It's God's way of order and discipline. And as we learned in the last lecture, first thing you do is you petition and prayerfully to our Father for His help. He's anxious. He's ready. He's got time for you. He wants to help. But you have to ask. That's one of the ifs in God's Word, and you must comply. Now he tells you how to choose, within this chapter, how to choose leaders, though actually, the thing you want to remember, he's the one that does the choosing. So I suppose what we have to do is to be able to recognize those that God gifts, that is to say, gives the talents, that they're able to teach, preach, evangelize, whatever the gift might be, the charisma, as it would be worded in the Greek. But it is something, and you'll be warned within this, never let that puff you up with pride, because it's not your gift, it's God's gift. In other words, God gives the gifts. So a man can hardly take credit for what God does for him. You have to naturally give honor to God, for it is He from whom all wisdom flows. Having said that, chapter 3, verse 1, a word of wisdom from our Father in Yeshua's name. Let's get into the offices of the church. Verse 1 reads, "This is a true saying." In other words, you can stand on this. It's a faithful saying. "If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work." Now, a bishop means an overseer, a leader, and it is a good work, but without God's help, it would really be trouble for someone, okay? You have to have God's help in overseeing a work of God. Why? It belongs to God. It is God's work. Verse 2, "A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach." That means able to teach. Well, what causes one to be apt or able to teach, to be a good teacher? Well, a gift from God and a lot of study. You can't teach something that you don't know. If it would seem that we have some people that just say, "Well, I've decided I want to be a teacher," but they have no idea. Probably if you ever feel you're led in that direction, the thing you would want to get settled in your mind is, teach what? And if it's God's word, then let it be God's word, and let all the other stuff, the traditions of men, fly by the wayside. You're not an apt teacher if you're not a teacher of God's word. That is to say, to represent the word of God and put it forth in a way of, in the simplicity in which Christ gave us the doctrine, that's to say, the truth, whereby we can follow, so simple a child can understand. And when you gain the knowledge and the study and the gift, and again the word gift, charisma, to then you have the charisma to do that, and it shows. Then you are apt. Now, what does it mean, blameless? Well, that means, that doesn't mean only in the church. A guy's reputation can stand the test. And this is why the idiom comes to my mind, you can pick up serpents and drink poison, the serpent can't bite you, which is a figure of speech, not talking about a snake. It's Satan can't harm you. Why? Because you have Christ as a shield. You have the gospel armor on. Satan hadn't got a, the serpent hadn't got a prayer of a chance of ever laying a hand on you. But the part I wanted to get to is the drinking of poison. It's not, you know, if you drink poison, your flesh body's going to die, all right? It's going to poison you and you will die. That's not what the word speaks of. It means your character is so good that it will withstand any poison that gossiping lips can throw at it. It just doesn't matter. As long as you know and God knows, that's enough. Then stand on that, act like it, behave like it. Why should a bishop be that, be one that gossip? He's blameless as far as gossip is concerned. Well, his character. No one represents someone that is not what they represent themselves as, okay? They can spot a fake 10 miles away. The husband of one wife. Now this, it would seem that many people, because of their lack of knowledge in the scripture, it was not uncommon among the Hebrews to have more than one wife, number one. But there's only one way that as you come into Christianity, we were to have one wife. Now, many people then will take it, they add the next step to it because of the doctrine of Christ, that if a man divorce a woman and she remarry, they commit adultery. That's if they don't repent and have a clean start. You see, there is a bill of divorcement that is acceptable to God. Bad as it may be, and divorce is as bad as a death, practically, as far as emotions within a family. It's very hurtful. And certainly, but at the same time, what happens if a, let me use an example here, a hypothetical situation. Let's say that a man is married to a woman, and let's say that she is unfaithful, and for that reason he writes her a bill of divorcement, which is biblical, and he repents to Almighty God for any part that he might have had in her losing interest in him. You know, it always takes two to tango, all right? Nobody's perfect. And then he repents, then God gives him a new sheet in the page in the book of life, that is to say, a clean start. So, in other words, because of the bill of divorcement and repentance, he has no wife. If he remarries, he has only one wife because God allowed him to put the other to one side. Now, many people like to take Christianity and put people in bondage to make second-class citizens. When God's, this is a scripture, God's gifts are given without repentance. In other words, if God gives a man or woman charisma, the gift, whatever that gift might be, it might be teaching, tongues, whatever the case, it's God's gift. It's given without repentance, meaning that God's not going to take that gift back, but that person surely will love God enough to repent. And Christians in good standing are blessed with forgiveness, and they will forgive the shortfall, knowing that Christianity, the greatest thing about it, gives us freedom. Learn the truth, and it will set you free, rather than being a bunch of self-righteous hypocrites that are always pointing fingers at people, gossiping, rather than being the forgiving family of God that God uses and blesses. So you see, many churches, I feel, err in the fact that because of this very scripture, only a man and one wife, well, he's divorced once, well, he can't, I know he was a wonderful teacher. He had a gift from God, and God gives gifts. His gifts are given without repentance. No, which, what does that mean? It means God's not going to take it away from him. He expects him to use it, or her, whichever the case might be. Therefore, naturally, with repentance and forgiveness, that's the greatest gift in Christianity, is forgiveness. It is just really sad that more churches do not practice forgiveness and understanding. For a church must deal with human beings. I haven't found too many perfect ones. We all fall short. But in Christ, we become perfect for that period of time, but not wearing that pridefully, but humbly and thankfully. Okay, I think we've said enough on that. Vigilant, one must always be aware and on guard and searching, looking, to vigorously seek the truth, to be sober. That means when this doesn't mean that you can't enjoy and have laughter occasionally, but it means when a time comes to be serious, and think on your feet, right? Of good behavior everywhere. That's very important. Given to hospitality. And again, as we concluded, apt to teach. It is deaktios in the Greek, and it means able, given, a good teacher, all right? Because a teacher sent of God is always a good teacher. They'll get the job done. That's just the way it is. That's God's promise. Verse 3, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre. God will not send out a beggar. And if you've got somebody that about half the time all they can do is beg, well, then they're not trusting God. They don't have the faith to know that if they have the gift to teach or whatever their gift might be, God will support their ministry. They don't have to beg, all right? But patient, not a brawler, not covetous. That's to say not jealous, because the Joneses seem to get ahead a little bit or whatever the case may be. Now, not given to much wine. That means a drunkard. You've got to control yourself, all right? And no striker. That means one that does not, because of their personality, are able to lead people without whipping them into shape. Now, no striker doesn't mean that if you're a Christian and you're walking down the street and a bully comes along and strikes you, protect yourself. Doesn't have anything to do with that. And love is always in the process of teaching respect and love. If someone comes along that is a striker and has a way of trying to kind of running over people, run over him once. Show him what it feels like. That's a form of teaching. And if he strikes you, deck him, all right? And, well, I never heard a preacher talk like that. Well, I'm sorry, but that's the way it is. If one is teaching God's word and mistakenly goes too far and another minister strike him, or someone is offended by the fact that he did not use good judgment, then turn the other cheek. And to love your enemy, yes. But if you love someone, you correct them also, and sometimes it takes a two before. That's not brawling, causing trouble. That's keeping discipline. Verse 4, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. On whatever level the situation might arise, Practice discipline on that level and your children will love you. Children love discipline. Show me a child that is not disciplined and I will show you a child that does not know whether a parent truly loves them or not. They don't know where the line is. So they float, they drift. Verse 5, Prin, for if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Question. And it's just that simple. You couldn't. If you did not have the ability to discipline those you really love and care for, then how could you possibly discipline with love an entire church? They would eat you alive if you did not have the ability to demand respect. God's gift always will make room for itself. Do you understand what I'm saying? If God gives you a gift of teaching or of evangelizing, that gift will always make room for itself. You don't have to force it. And that in itself is a way that brings order into a group. At the same time, you have to practice tough love occasionally. You run the house of God in an orderly way. As a matter of fact, in the last lecture, we heard that a woman should be silent. And I said, anytime that God's meeting is being conducted, both male and female will remain silent. You will zip it. You will not speak out at whatever chance you so choose if we're respecting the Word of God and are in a class of teaching. You're not going to open your mouth or you're not going to stay. So there requires discipline in the house of God the same as there does the house at home. And don't confuse the discipline of both at home. A home is not is a place for teaching God's Word, but it's also a home where a family should be happy and enjoy each other. Verse 6. Not a novice. And this is important. Lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Well, what caused the devil to fall? Well, it was pride. Ezekiel chapter 28, verses, say, 14 through 19, tell you how that he swelled up. He had an important job. I mean, after all, he was guarding the mercy seat. That's important. And he let that go to his little old head, and he became so important, he decided, if I guard the mercy seat, I'll just sit on her. People love me. Well, what's a novice? A novice is a beginner. A novice, or one new to the truth, is not ready to teach or head a church. It would be one of the most cruel things in the world is to take a novice and put him at the head of a church. And because someone new to the truth, you have to have knowledge, experience. You have to be able to truly know how to bring God's blessings upon a family that is in need or help of guidance and so forth. So why? Because a novice many times will, as Satan said, pride will come to their head because that responsibility is released to them. And it takes a little maturity to know that the gift that God gives you, even if you be a novice, is still God's gift, not yours. That has a way of humbling one, whereby they can deal with that condemnation that Satan might bring upon you by making you feel like in your own heart you're really something, when really it's our Father's gift that is really something, okay? These are very important points in a church. And thank goodness for people when, say, a pastor is absent, that a new student who has the ability to speak would fill in. And God bless them for that. But we're talking here about bishops, the head of the church, okay? Verse 7, moreover, besides all that, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. What does it mean, without? Well, it means people that are not even church members in your community. In other words, if a man is going to head a church, he must have a good report in his community. He's not a thief. Why? Well, were he to be a thief, that would break the commandment, thou shalt not steal, and the reputation would fall out on the church. There are nothing but a bunch of thieves down there. Or let's say that he was a striker, a brawler, a troublemaker. Let it always be said that a man, woman, or child of God takes care of their own part of civic duties that are respectable and necessary. And let it always be said that he has a good reputation, that his name has a good name recognition, and that it is respected as one that if he gives his bond, his word, it is kept. Because that brings honor to the church and it draws people to the church. Whereas someone that does not pay their bills, feeling that they, and I've seen this in my lifetime, it would seem that some preachers think that a business should give them whatever they need, no cost. Why? Because they be preach and they be church. God doesn't work that way. God wants a good reputation throughout the whole community. You pay your bills, you give your word, you keep it. That's where a real, true leader of a church must act. Now, as I said, these rules can be applied to your family likewise. You can't go wrong as the head of your family. For it is part of the body of Christ that bearing in mind these things. People that take shortcuts and try to snitch a little here and snitch a little there, that flies. That word about you flies in a community. Nobody's going to like you, nor are they going to do business with you whereby you can prosper. So, you rob no one but yourself and your church when you try things like that. Always. Why does it say reproach and the snare of the devil? Because that's the way the devil sets traps, is to deal with people's weaknesses. So if you're going to head the church, don't have a weakness in your community above what is normal in life. Have a good reputation. Why? Well, that draws people to, you know, if people see you prosperous, got a good head on your shoulders, can give good advice that helps people, they're drawn to that. And what does that build? You? No. It builds the church because it helps people. That's why a church is successful. It helps people, whether it be knowledge, whether it be advice as how to be successful in life, how to have peace of mind, that draws people. See that you practice and don't take shortcuts whereby the devil can destroy the church. Because if you're a thief, the devil's going to pass the word around through wicked little gossiping lips, and the church is going to go down with a bad reputation. Verse 8. Likewise, must the deacons, let's classify deacons as helpers, okay? Be grave, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy of filthy lucre. God doesn't want his people to be a bunch of beggars. So that makes it pretty easy to separate true Christians, true churches, from those that are a bunch of beggars, all right? That's just, God doesn't approve of that. If you do as he instructs you, he will see that the finances take care of themselves and you have nothing whatsoever to worry about. Not double-tongued. You know, double-tongued, that's to have deacons within the church or to help people, and if you have two sets of standards for different people, you're going to be hated, okay? You treat everybody the same. And the truth applies not to some people and a different truth to others. The truth will always make room for itself. So a double-tongued person is nothing but trouble going somewhere to happen. And if you put a person with a double tongue, the American Indian calls it a forked tongue. That's an old saying. Which, you know what has a forked tongue? A serpent does, and it is straight from the devil. So certainly never elevate someone that's a money grubber and a person that is not grave, meaning to have serious faith in God, to realize the position and responsibility, and not given to much wine, meaning one that doesn't just take wine at communion or whatever the case may be, but is a glutton for it. Everything in moderation for serving God. Verse 9, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. That's necessary. You must know the mystery of God. You must know the mystery of faith. Well, what is it? Well, we'll talk about it here in a moment. Verse 10, and let these also first be proved. If they don't know the mystery, they can't be a deacon, they can't be a bishop, because they wouldn't know the mystery of faith. That is to say, how to have faith and have it stick. Then let them use the office of a deacon being found blameless. That is to say, let them prove themselves, and they shall. And then are they worthy. Verse 11, even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, that means double-tongued tale-bearers, sober, faithful in all things. Your word must be good. Your word must be your bond. Verse 12, let the deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own houses well. That again, as it was with the deacon, so it is with them. And certainly, it becomes the bishop, the head of the church, to have a people that follow the footsteps of Christ. And Christ set the example even for the bishop. 13. For they that have used the office of a deacon, well, purchased to themselves a good degree and great boldness in the faith which is in Christ Jesus. They can speak boldly concerning Christ Jesus. They can speak in such a way. Well, what is this mystery? Holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. What is the mystery of the faith? What's the faith? It's the doctrine, the faith in Christ's word, that what he does is well and good. And if you are short on knowledge and you do not understand the mystery of God, what does that speak of? What does that speak of? Matthew chapter 13, you're not going to have it, but listen carefully. Matthew 13, verse 35, that it might be fulfilled. This is the parable of the sower. If you don't understand this parable, which is the mystery of God, you won't understand any. That's the teachings of Christ in Luke 4. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret. The mystery from the foundation of the world. And Jesus then sent the multitude away, and they asked him, well, tell us what this is. Don't speak in parables, tell us. So he's not speaking in a parable. He answered in verse 37 and said unto them, He that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. That is to say, when the Spirit moved upon the earth, man was created and so forth. Verse 38, the field is the world, meaning this world age. The good seed are the children of the kingdom. That's the children of this church we're talking about. But the tares are the children of the wicked one. Well, who's the wicked one? Well, I would hope you would know that. That's Satan, of course. 39, the enemy that sowed them is the devil. And of course, he's speaking of Cain and his children. The harvest is the end of the world and the reapers the angels. Don't, you know, if you do not, this is why the only two churches that Christ was pleased with in Revelation chapter 2 and 3 had the knowledge of the secret of the faith. That is to say, who would know, as it is written concerning Smyrna and Philadelphia, the churches? Those who know who those are that claim to be of our brother Judah, but are of this synagogue of Satan, meaning the serpent, the devil that planted them. You have to know that mystery, or they're not going to be worth a flip in the church. Because from that then comes the key of David and the knowledge and the understanding of the mystery of the faith. Let us continue with the next verse in chapter 3 of Timothy, verse 14. These things write I unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. I really want to spend some time with you. 15, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God. This is the way you do it, which is the church of the living God, not the dead God. The living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. It is God's household, it is the truth, and this is the way it operates. If it operates different than this, it will fail. Verse 16, and without controversy, great is the mystery. There's that mystery again. Mystery of what? Is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. Well, now, wait a minute. What is that saying? God was manifest in the flesh. Does that saying God came in the flesh? Well, what would you think it said? Let's read it again. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the Spirit. That means the Holy Spirit. God's Spirit is the Holy Spirit. Why did they call him Emmanuel? God with us, God in the flesh. Seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, that's to say nations, translated properly, all of them. Believed on in the world, received up into glory. And he was received up, and there he sits at the right hand of God. Your counselor, your comforter, advisor, lawyer, if you wish, right at the right hand of God. Why? He was God in the flesh. Many people say, well, I don't like the way that reads. Well, you really should like God's word if you understand the mystery of God. Otherwise, you're in trouble, friend. I know you don't have a happy life, and I feel sorry for you. Because God's mystery is a beautiful thing. It details his love for his children. It details his love for his church. His church, not some playhouse. Not one of those houses he calls a house of harlotry that claims to be a house of God. That means that deals in traditions of men rather than real word of God, taught properly, chapter by chapter and verse by verse, flowing whereby it is the word of God and not the word of man, this man or any other man. That's why you want to learn to study for yourself, to show yourself approved, to not be a novice if you intend to really lead your family into peace of mind. God is not the author of confusion, but of peace of mind. And when you follow Him, when you love Him, He will see that you have that peace of mind. So, in that chapter, we have the rules for the house of God. There is no substitute. Well, that's sure very simple. Of course it is. All of God's word is simple. All you have to do is follow it. I guess that's what gets difficult, isn't it? Well, I hope you can, because it's the only way to find true, lasting happiness in the mystery of God, understanding His word, which is really no mystery at all. It's laid out in the simplistic teachings of Christ before our very eyes, in the simplistic teaching of God with us. It's pretty difficult when you do not accept God with us, for there is only one God. Think about it. All right, bless your heart. You listen a moment, won't you please?